Gracious God, thank you for this morning. Thank you for the joy of your presence. Thank you for the gospel, your gospel, that comes through our Lord Jesus Christ and is appropriated in our lives by the Holy Spirit. We bless you and honor you. We pray your presence with us this morning as we think together about this text. For Christ's sake. Amen. It is easy to start one's study of Romans at 1:16, since for most people that's where the argument begins. We have a rather truncated way of doing Romans in the church, and for most people Romans begins at 1:16. It is of some interest that, of course, that sentence is dependent upon verse 15, that it's not an independent sentence that begins something, but it is an explanatory sentence coming out of verses 14 and 15. In any case, to start at 1:16 is to miss far too much, not only because so many hints as to purpose and concern emerge in verses 1 to 17, but also, as I've already indicated, verses 16 and 17 themselves so clearly belong to verses 14 and 15, which in turn are closely linked to verses 10 to 13. But as with so much in this letter, this opening material is full of surprises. The form is easy enough. As with most of Paul's letters, it has the very straightforward form of the three-part salutation. Paul to believers in Rome, greetings. But Paul's letters simply begin this way. Paul, usually something about himself, which is standard here, to those who are in Rome, a couple of things about them. And then grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ is found in that form in what, 8 of the 10 letters written to churches? Well, the 10 letters other than the pastorals, which then would include Philemon. And although Philemon is addressed to Philemon, it's also, of course, addressed to the church in Colossae. So that's very standard stuff. And then, of course, it's followed immediately by a thanksgiving and prayer report. I thank my God for all of you as I unceasingly pray for you. I mean, just simply lift those materials out. If you put it another way, if you were to simply lift out verses 1, 7, 8, and 10, you would have the absolutely standard Pauline prescript to his letter. Three-part salutation, thanksgiving, and prayer. And sometimes, of course, a prayer report. Now, as with most of Paul's letters, these various items sometimes are elaborated. The surprise in Romans is not only the nature and length of one of these elaborations, but also the nature of, that is, of the first elaboration, the nature of the second one. That is, it's a considerable elaboration that takes place in the salutation, the three-part salutation. And then there's another considerable elaboration in the Thanksgiving prayer report. So that when we finally get into the middle of that prayer report, you get the feeling that the prayer, that this is no longer the content of his prayer. Something has obviously happened as he's reporting on his praying for them and what it is he prays, and then he goes on to make a considerable explanation of that. And it's that explanation about his praying that finally then evolves into, another explanatory sentence, verses 16 and 17, which most people recognize functions in some way as the or at least an introductory theme to Romans. a little reluctant to call it the theme of Romans. It certainly sets Romans in perspective, but it doesn't cover all the ground. But in any case, it's sort of an introductory thematic sentence. So the fact that we have this standard stuff, as I say, if you just had verses 1, 7, 8, and 10, we would begin with verse 16. As we'd make a few comments on those, but we would get over that quickly and get on with verse 16. But it's the fact that he elaborates, which is of course not a surprise, but the what and the nature of that of those elaborations that give us reason to pause. Now, to get at all of this, let's begin by noting the pure forms, which, when I say pure, that's in quotes for me, the pure forms are already Paulinized. That is, Paul has already touched a standard kind of formulation. The salutation, verses 1 to 7. I've already noted that the pure form is found in verses 1 and 7. Paul, servant or slave of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle. Sometimes that comes out slightly differently. This is the only place, in fact, where we have the double designation, slave of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle. But nothing unusual there. Usually he says apostle through the will of God or the command of God or something like that, which isn't here. Skip down to verse 7. Those who are in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints. Nothing surprising or unusual there. We'll make a note of that when we come to it in a moment. And then, of course, grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. But the bulk of this material, verses 1 to 7, and I'm thinking now of the Greek text. There are 12 lines in the standard Greek text. And I'm counting lines in the Nestle-Aulin Greek text. Of the 12 lines of this text, 8 of them are given over to a very considerable elaboration of what it means for Paul to be called to be an apostle. And even that, what it means for him to be called to be an apostle, really only emerges down here in verse 5, which then is picked up a bit in an elaborate way, which has to do with what it means for him to be an apostle to the Gentiles, and hence his reason for writing to Rome. But before we get to that, what we have is an elaboration of the gospel, which also is very unusual. First of all, because it focuses on the gospel itself, but in this case, not as in the rest of Romans, not in terms of what the gospel is or what the gospel does, but in terms of who the gospel is about. It's a highly unusual moment in Paul, actually. That is, ordinarily when Paul starts to say something about the gospel, his instincts are to say something about what the gospel does. But in this case, you can read it through. There's nothing about how the gospel is effective in people's lives or what God is doing in the gospel with regard to salvation. I mean, quite different, you see, from verse 16. I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation. I mean, that's what we expect when Paul elaborates on the gospel, but quite different here. That's, in fact, the surprise factor in this opening passage. Given how Romans falls out, what is going on in these verses 2 to 6, especially verses 2 to 4? The only other place Paul does anything quite like this in his salutations is in Galatians. In that case, the elaboration takes place after the salutation proper, where he says, "Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who..." And then he has this considerable sentence with regard to Christ. But different from this one, which has to do with something about Christ himself, the one in Galatians goes like this: "Who gave himself for our sins so that he might rescue us from this present evil age." Clearly the interest is in salvation in Christ. That is, that the interest in Christ is in the saving work of Christ. not on who Christ is in that case. So we have this, first of all, this interesting thing that happens in this case. The second thing Paul does in the elaboration is to focus on his own role in the gospel, and here with special emphasis on his being an apostle. It comes out first in verse 1. His being called to be an apostle is immediately qualified in terms of his having been set apart with regard to the gospel. And then after this elaboration about the gospel itself, in verse 5, he returns to his calling and apostleship, which focuses first of all on the sphere of his endeavor, namely all the Gentiles, and then the purpose of his apostleship, which is the obedience of faith on the part of all the Gentiles. Now, obviously, we'll have to come back to all of these things. I'm just at this point, and I'll do this on a regular basis, just simply go through an overview of the whole section that we're dealing with, and then we'll come back and look at some of the details that as we look at the nature of the argumentation of the whole, and this, of course, is not argumentation, but in effect it is. We look at the nature of the argumentation as a whole and see what it is he's doing and how it's working. Then we'll come back and look at some of the details as we have time. Now, I want to just note finally that he concludes the elaboration by including the believers in Rome, which tells us, first, that he perceives the congregation as primarily Gentile. I mean, if you were to read this salutation, you would not think that there are any Jews present at all. And secondly, that what he is doing is undoubtedly his delicate way of justifying such a long letter to a group of believers who are not his and therefore are not related to his apostolic authority. That is, notice how it goes. His own calling and apostleship is for the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles. And once he's made that point, then he says, among whom also you. So it's the very fact that his apostleship is for all the Gentiles that gives him the authority to write to the church in Rome that is not one of his own. Because you are among the Gentiles. I mean, that's how he's pulling this off. So my apostleship has to do with the gospel, Christ. It has to do with bringing the gospel, which brings obedience on the basis of faith, to all the Gentiles. And then, of course, among all the Gentiles, you are to be included. So, and then, of course, he says something more about them. Now, it shouldn't take any particularly deep insight to recognize that this is a highly unusual moment in Paul, and needs some explanation, part of which will be forthcoming in the next matter, the thanksgiving and prayer report, which begins in verse 8. And as we look at that next now, we'll see that part of our explanation for what's going on in verses 1 to 7 is going to be helped by looking at this next section, which I couldn't get onto. Now, as with the salutation, the introductory matters, the thanksgiving is absolutely standard Paul. Verse 8. It comes to us in three parts. First, there's the statement of thanksgiving itself. I thank my God. He ordinarily says, I thank God. This is the first of his letters in which he says, I thank my God. And then he does this again in Philippians and Philemon. So apparently this is something that begins to develop in the later parts of his ministry. But it's standard stuff. I thank my God. The unusual expansion through Jesus Christ, we'll come back and say a bit a few minutes later. But just to recognize how standard this is, the second, of course, is the focus of the thanksgiving, which is always for the people themselves. I thank my God for all of you. How radically different from most of our praying and thanking. We tend to thank God for things and events. Paul's thanksgivings invariably are for people. I thank my God for all of you. Now, very often, not always, but very often in his thanksgiving, then he will also give a reason for his thanking God for them. Take Philippians, for example. I thank my God for all of you, every prayer of mine, mentioning you in my prayer, for your koinonia in the gospel from the beginning until now. So that's the basis for the thanksgiving. Thanksgiving is for them, but in the thanksgiving and praying, he's reminded of their long history of partnership with him in the gospel. So here we have the same thing, the reason for the thanksgiving. That he would do so is certainly standard, but how he expresses it in this case is where the surprises begin now in this letter. Not altogether, but somewhat. It's the only other place something like this happens is in 1 Thessalonians. Namely, he thanks God that their faith is being announced all over the world. Before I write to you, I have already been in prayer and thanksgiving for you because your faith is simply being noted everywhere. The whole world. Well, at least in the world that Paul knows. He knows he's continually getting reports about the church in Rome. Now, the same thing is true, that is the standard stuff, the same thing is true with the prayer report. The form is quite standard. In this case, it picks up at the end of verse 9. I continually mention you, always in my prayers, requesting. It's a bit of an awkward thing. It's a compounding of mentioning them. That is, he compounds the fact that he does this unceasingly and always. That happens elsewhere, by the way. Unceasingly mentioning you always in my prayers. This is the way it tends to go. So, nothing about that that's strange at all. But the content of the prayer is where all of the surprise comes and begins to offer all kinds of further clues about the letter. For indeed, the most remarkable thing about this section of the material, and it's remarkable in that you look at all the rest of Paul's thanksgivings and prayers that begin the letters, and invariably he prays for them in some way. But the moment he starts to talk, and he says he mentions them in prayer, and that means he does pray for them. That is, as he gives the point that needs to be noted, and we'll not come back to that, so we'll note it here, is that these sentences are broken up in this case, but in every other case the sentences go together, that Paul's thanksgiving takes place in the context of his praying. A very, very important point to make. His praying is not separated from his thanksgiving. A part of his praying for them is thanksgiving for them. Simply the way that's the way he is. In this case, it gets broken up by this little insertion of this oath, God is my witness. That itself is striking and stunning. But when he gets to the prayer, we just take the little oath out for a minute. You've got, I give thanks to God through Christ Jesus, mentioning you always in my praying. It finally comes down to it, in verse 9b, mentioning you always in my praying. Then what you expect is for him to say something about what it is that he prays about them. And instead, what we get in this case is that his prayer has to do with his coming to see them. Now, that's prayer for them in an indirect way. But it has to do with not just praying for them and, if you will, their needs and what's going on. And it's undoubtedly that he intends that when he begins the praying, when he mentions every mention of you. It's hard to imagine that his prayer does not include the very things he's going to write about in this letter. It's hard to imagine that that's not true. But right in the middle of this sentence, what gets into focus for Paul is as he prays for these people who are not his converts, but he prays for them on an ongoing basis. His concern is his relationship with them. That's already been hinted at back in verses 5 and 6 in that unusual moment in the salutation. And now, everything focuses on his relationship with them, which, of course, up to this point hasn't existed. So what he's focusing on is his hoped-for relationship with them. So it's his desire to visit them that becomes the content of the prayer. Now, what happens then is that he elaborates now, this, as he did in the earlier part, and the elaboration, which in the first case gives thanks for their faith that is becoming universally known. Paul does this elsewhere. 1 Thessalonians 1:7, 2 Thessalonians 1:3, he thanks God for their faith, and then that faith is known in some way, Colossians 1:4. But in this case, where Paul sometimes gives thanks for their faith, which usually needs to be understood as faith / faithfulness, that is, it's not just their initial trust in Christ, you understand, it's their ongoing trust in Him. Faith becomes faithfulness. The fruit of the Spirit is faith. Paul does not mean their saving faith. He means ongoing trust, faithfulness. It gets translated that way in your English Bibles. The fruit of the Spirit is faithfulness. The word is faith. I mean, it's what he's thanking God for, is their faith. But in this case, that their faith or faithfulness, faithful trust in Christ, is known everywhere. Now, here, if you will, is the tacit acknowledgement that they're an established congregation. And as we will learn momentarily, that he has had nothing at all to do with their coming to faith. Again, an apparent recognition on his part of the unusual nature. And as I say, a recognition on his part of the unusual nature of this letter. I mean, the moment you start getting into the letter and read it in light of all the rest of his letters, you recognize that he himself recognizes there's an unusual, you know, what he's doing is unusual for him. He's not used to doing this. He doesn't usually write to churches that are not his own. And it's trying to get at that, you know, if you will, to establish the basis for their hearing him out. I need to put by way of parenthesis here, because we'll come back to it from time to time, but Paul very clearly understands his letters to take the place of his personal presence. And he also understands his letters to therefore be a prophetic word, that is, a word from the Holy Spirit that is being prophetically spoken into their midst. And that can be established on a whole lot of grounds, but there's very little question of that. That is, and therefore you need to understand, and you need to hear well, the fact is that this is going to be read in church. And it's not going to be read as missionary letters are read in our churches or something like that. It's going to be read in church in the same way that Scripture is read in church. It's a very important point to make. People ask, where does canonical authority come from in the Pauline letters or the apostolic letters? And I'll tell you, it comes from the fact that their very first reading takes place in church in the context of a situation where the only other thing that's read in church is Scripture. I mean, it's very authoritative kind of thing going on. Yes, David.
Why would they perceive that this way? Is this tradition?
Well, when you say canonical authority, of course, that's putting it backwards. But what earns him his hearing, of course, in all of his other letters? I mean, if he only had Romans, that becomes, as I say, that's what makes Romans such an interesting moment for us. Because the rest of his letters, the authority is that he is an apostle of Jesus Christ to the people who are receiving the letter. And therefore, he speaks into their midst. My sentences to you were carefully put in order. He understands his letters to take the place of his personal presence. And when he's present among them, he speaks authoritatively in their midst. So he is. He's the apostle, called to be an apostle through Christ Jesus. So the fact that he does this when he's present with them personally, he understands his letters to take the place of his personal presence. It's just, there's all kinds of evidence that we can show that this is so. That's why in 1 Corinthians, for example, when Paul says, and when you assemble together and my spirit is present, he means I'm present by the Holy Spirit. In that context, and of course it means in the context of their reading that letter right at that point, they are to turn this man over to Satan. I mean, that's, the authority lies in the fact that when they assemble together the power of the Lord Jesus and Paul is present in the letter, the Spirit of God is present speaking through Paul in that letter, they're to act. It's very strong kind of authoritative stuff. It's same is true in Philippians. It's going to be read in church as a word to the community that comes from the Spirit through Paul. So out of that, the very fact that that happens means that they probably read these letters again and again when Paul isn't present. And you understand, what finally makes the canon develop the way it does is two things. Namely, is it apostolic in some way or another? And is it read in church? Because what's read in church is Scripture. Simple as that. And what isn't read in church isn't Scripture. This is why the Muratorian canon can tell them, urge them to read the Shepherd of Hermas, but not in church. Because the moment they read it in church, that gives it canonical authority. So it's the reading in church that finally establishes the canonicity of these materials. And people who think, well, you know, the church is sort of, you know, in a kind of accidental historical way ended up with these letters. Well, that's not quite true. These letters are preserved and read in the churches precisely because they're read in church at the very beginning as an authoritative prophetic word into their midst. Now, not all of the letters that Paul wrote apparently were kept in that way, but many of them were. We have those. Now, my point is, back to this particular letter, is that it's fun to watch what Paul is doing here, because whereas he would speak in a quite different way to one of his own churches, here is a certain sense in which he's, in a sense, trying to justify their reading this in church. What's going to cause them to do it? Of course, when I say read in church, don't think of one of our churches with 500 seats and somebody, you know, saying, we're thinking of house churches and in the context of their gathering. What I would like to know that caused all of this to come about, as I was thinking about all of this in the process of the lecture, is that this letter is going to be a long one, and is it going to be read all at one time? The answer is probably yes. I'm not going to simply read it through. And you say, how could they have done it? Well, the answer is very simple. The difference between them and us is so severe at this point that it's almost impossible for us to ever enter into their mind. And it's the difference between what I call a basically oral culture and a basically literary culture. Ours is a basically literary culture. And I say ours, I mean Western civilization and all Asian civilizations that have been deeply impacted by the West. Basically literary cultures. Most people read and write. Our thinking is what's written, to read. And when we think read by ourselves. Silently. People didn't begin to read silently until somewhere in the 16th century. Everybody read aloud when they were by themselves. Reading was an oral expression from the very beginning. Everybody read aloud. And in a culture where the minority read, you understand, somebody is reading for the rest to hear. Listen to the revelation, how it begins, where he says, blessed is the one who reads this and those who hear. Man, I know what 20th century Westerns do with that. They think in terms of reading it privately and then hearing it preached in church. No, the blessing is upon the reader of the text as it's being read as a prophetic word and the hearers to hear it as the prophetic word. There's a clear evidence of what's going on in these kinds of texts. But you understand that the great advantage they had over us is precisely because for us it's written in a book and we can always go back and consult the book. We don't have to ever remember anything. And most of us have very, very poor memories. We do some rote stuff to pass exams. But we don't have good memories in the sense of when we hear something, we have it. You get into any oral culture where truth is transmitted by stories. And some of you come from those kinds of cultures where, I think, for example, in India, where a great number of people in much of the culture are still going to transmit their truths by story. The ability to remember and to repeat is incredibly higher than ours. We've just sublimated all of that stuff because we can consult the book. So yeah, they're going to read the whole thing in church. It's going to be a long sitting, but it's all right. They probably read an awful lot of the Old Testament at one sitting. And they know it well. That's why all this argument in Romans that is to a primarily Gentile church is full of Scripture. Because they know the Scriptures better than you do. I'm prepared to say that they know it better than you do, even if you're an Old Testament major. They just know it because they hear it read all the time. It's a part of their whole life. So this is going to be read. Well, that was a bit of a digression, but it has something to do with the fact that this is going to be read in the churches, in the house churches in Rome. And Paul knows that. And it's anticipation of that, the fact that they're not his own converts. So his prayer for them has been of this, not of the usual kind, but of this rather unusual kind. Now, point then is that this material is full of items that call for our attention. First, that it begins with an oath formula in verse 9 is especially noteworthy. I mean, why would Paul say, God is my witness about all of, about the fact that I pray for you all the time? And the oath formula comes by way of a gar, that is by way of a for God is my witness. That is, it comes by way of explanation, an explanation that requires some missing links to be filled in, very frankly. The very fact that he says for and then has the oath just calls for our filling out some missing links in here. And I think it goes something like this. Their faith is world-renowned. Then he goes, for God is my witness. How that in praying for you I continually request that. And then he goes on. The connections between all of these things are not immediately visible. Now, what are the missing links? Well, probably, first, that they're already an established church, and Paul knows that. And secondly, that he has had nothing to do with their being established. Yet, and now this is what's going on, they are not thereby any less related to him in Christ. That is, even though they are not his converts, they are still his in the broader relational sense of being in Christ. And furthermore, and this now becomes part of the letter to Romans, it's the capital, because of their significance in the capital of the empire, he longs to have had a part in their coming to faith, but in any case, since he did not, he still wants to have a part in who they are in Christ. So, what's happening is that here's a church that's already well established. He and they belong to one another by virtue of their relationship to Christ. It's quite clear by what he says in verses 13, 14, 15. He would have liked to have had a part in their becoming who they are. And he makes no bones of that. But since he didn't have a part in their becoming who they are, he still would like to have a part in them. And that's why he's now going to write the letter. And that's what he's going to go on and explain in verses 13 to 15. Now, so that brings me to verse 11. I mean, the reason he's wanted to come to them is that he might impart some spiritual gift, that you might be strengthened. Now, first of all, that's obvious that's a church that's already established. They're already established, but he wants to impart some spiritual gift that they may be strengthened. Now, as I suggested last time, I would dare to propose that we must take this seriously as a primary reason for the letter. That is, the letter is going to function as that spiritual gift for them to be strengthened. But after the proper disclaimer in verse 12, which we'll come back to, he picks this theme up again in verse 13b, that I may have some fruit among you, even as among the rest of the Gentile world. And that's picked up then again in verse 15 in terms of his being a debtor to all Gentiles of all kinds. And it's in that context, he says, it has been my desire to preach the gospel also to you in Rome. And it's that final sentence, his being debtor to all Gentiles and the desire to preach the gospel in Rome, that serves as the lead-in to what he wants to say in the letter itself, and thus the lead-in to verses 16 and 17. And once we get to verses 16 and 17, all kinds of things differ. I do these structural analyses and color them, but in my color scheme, the blue is always the Apostle Paul, and green is always, in some way, the people to whom he's writing. it doesn't take very long. Let's skip back through. And all the way down, it's until you get down to verse 6 that you have any green at all, and then you have the stand. So all the way down here. But there's not much about Paul. Verse 1 and then again verse 5. So the elaborations take place outside of Paul and the Romans themselves. Well, then come to verses 8 to 12, and you'll notice now the mixture of blue and green. It's all about Paul, and that's what dominates this material. And the same is true when you come down to verses 14 following. It's still dominated by this I and you, this relational stuff between them. It just dominates. That gives you a clue, by the way. This little color scheme is just a way of stepping back and looking at the text and seeing what makes up most of the stuff. What's the content mostly about? It's always an eye catcher for me. It highlights some things, just help me to see what's going on in the text. But then the moment you get to verse 16, all of that changes. Paul says, I'm not ashamed, but everything then has to do with the gospel and Christ and the gospel and God and the one who believes, which is now a more universal kind of thing and not directed specifically toward any one person in the church in Rome. Well, this final thing, verse 16 and 17, clearly starts. I mean, everybody recognizes it. It's all been called the theme of Romans, and I quite agree. In many ways, that's true. But what you need to recognize is how he gets there. He gets there by verse 15. My desire has been to preach the gospel even among those of you who are in Rome, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel. You understand? That's how it works. Now, this is where he's been wanting to get to all along. And it took him all the rest of this material in order to get there. Now, I want us to go back now and look at some of this material in a bit of detail. Now, I want to say a few things about verse 1. This is the only instance where the double identification I've already indicated, doulos of Christ Jesus. Now, it is of some interest to me that he begins that way. In all of the letters written to his churches, let me back that up. There is no identification at all in 1 and 2 Thessalonians. It's almost the certain evidence that they're the earliest of the two of the Pauline letters. Those letters are simply Paul and Silas and Timothy to the church in Thessalonica. And then even the salutation in the first one is not complete. It's grace and peace to you, that's all. But once you get past 1 and 2 Thessalonians, then you have some stuff that becomes standard in Paul. And in that standard stuff, beginning with 1 Corinthians, Paul always identifies himself as an apostle, with the one exception of Philippians. The reason for it, of course, in Philippians is that that's a letter of friendship, and the relationship is not apostle and converts, but those who have been in partnership with him in the gospel all of his life. So he writes to them and identifies himself with this phrase, servant or slave of Christ Jesus. That's the one he begins with in Romans. Slave of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle. And you'll notice that even about the apostleship, he repeats the thing he does in 1 Corinthians, that his apostleship is a calling. That is, he immediately focuses the direction toward God, that his apostleship is God's calling, or Christ's calling, whichever. And that what he is as an apostle is a doulos of Christ Jesus. Now the problem, of course, is translating doulos. Because the word means slave. And there's not a person, I mean, you're not a person in this culture who, hearing him say doulos, Jesu Christu, could have ever heard anything other than slave. You understand? They couldn't have heard anything else. But it's not quite as easy as that. This past summer in the NIV revision, we were working our way through Philippians and Galatians and some other Pauline letters. We had started Philippians the summer before and stopped with this word. And rather than get hung up on it, we commissioned two of our members of the committee to do a special study on the use of this so that we would come to terms with how to translate it. They gave a special study. They didn't agree together, and we spent 3 hours. It's not an easy one. In fact, this is a perfect illustration of the difficulty of translation. Because there are certain places where it is almost impossible to go from the original language into the receptor language and be able to find a dynamic equivalent. Now, the problem with slave in English is that the vast majority of speakers of English in first language, meaning both in Great Britain and in North America, have everything they hear in the word slave enculturated by the terrible evil of British American slavery. And I have to say British American because the slavery in the United States was the direct result of the British slave trade. It took William Wilberforce, a Christian, to bring that thing to its end. But everybody's understanding of slavery, that is not everybody's, but the majority of people, slave means that incredibly demeaning, dehumanizing experience out of North American history that those of us who are generations after are still embarrassed by and feel the need to weep and repent of our national evil. So the moment you say slave, you're already using a word that wouldn't have meant the same thing first century, because a slave in the first century, and especially in the time that Paul writes this letter, the vast majority of slaves by the time of Paul have been born of slave parents. That is, they're slaves by birth. And furthermore, slavery was not racial in the first century. And I say racial carefully. Most people who became slaves as the result of war. That is, conquest would bring people and they would just simply become slaves. The only other way people entered into slavery was actually by selling themselves. That is, they couldn't make it in a culture. Once the slavery gets going, you understand, that's cheap labor. And so you have the very rich and then slaves, and there's the middle class just barely make their way through. And a lot of them don't make it, so they sold themselves into slavery. So it's a different kind of thing. I mean, I'm not saying that it's a good thing. It's still the bottom of the sociological pecking order, for sure. But many, many slaves who were given freedom continued to stay as attached freedmen in the house, so that there was, you know, it wasn't the dehumanizing thing. So the moment you say slave in English, how do you get back to their culture? Well, a part of the problem also for us, and here's the real problem, is that this is the word, doulos is the word that was used by the Septuagint translators to translate the Hebrew eved many times, and in every case when it says so-and-so was an eved Yahweh, so-and-so was a servant of the Lord. So Moses, the doulos of the Lord. Now, it came to be used then of people who are especially given to God in their lives. Moses, Daniel, can't remember, but there's about five or six of them, Joshua, the servant of the Lord, the servant of the Lord. Well, that doesn't mean the slave of the Lord. It means something closer to the servant of the Lord. So the problem, of course, now we're going to translate it. You translate it servant and you end up with something that loses an enormous amount of the impact that the word slave should have when we hear it. Namely, that these people are, in fact, belong to Christ. We're not just talking about, you know, those who can come and go and serve, but we're talking, you know, not just servant in some sort of casual way, but we're talking about someone who is the slave of Christ Jesus. Well, as I say, translation is nearly impossible, but the point for us here in this particular instance is that in approaching the Romans, that's the word he uses, slave of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle. Now, the moment he gets to that point, then he says, separated or set apart for the gospel of God, God's gospel. Now, Paul qualifies the word gospel in three ways. Six times he refers to my gospel, which he means something like the gospel I preach or the gospel as I preach it. Then 11 times he speaks of the gospel of Christ. And in this case, it's almost certainly an objective genitive, at least in most cases, meaning it's the gospel which has Christ as its content. But here, one of six times, he speaks of the gospel of God. And in this case, God is not the content of the gospel, but the source of the gospel. God's gospel. Now, the reason for saying that here is because, I need to say this now about Romans. In many ways, Romans is all about God. And I say that because the word God appears more in Romans than in all of Paul's letters, almost all of them combined. Far more than Christ comes God in Romans. I mean, it's about God. It's about what God is doing. Now, he does it through Christ. But it starts that way, and you don't get very far away from that in this opening stuff. So, it's God's gospel, which... And now he's going to say something about this gospel, and that leads us then to verse 2. Now, verse 2 begins an elaboration of the gospel, noted in the overview. But he begins an emphasis that is crucial to Paul's present enterprise. And there are three points that are made. First, in saying that it has been God promised it beforehand through the prophets in Holy Scripture, he's simply picking up the phrase, the gospel of God. God is not only the source of the gospel that Paul preaches, but he has already been at work in his ancient people. That is, what God is currently doing is something that's related to what he has been doing. Secondly, now about the whole elaboration, the gospel, which has Christ as its essential content, is first of all to be understood as the fulfillment of God's promises. God promised it beforehand. That is, it's not only that this is something that God is doing and it's related to something that God has been doing, but it's especially related to God's promises. Very important way Paul understands our Christian existence as the people of God is it belongs to the promise and a fulfillment. Now, this is eschatological language. It's the language of promise and fulfillment, and it's going to become key to what goes on in verses 3 and 4. Well, then third, the gospel is thus rooted, first of all, in what God did in his ancient people through the prophets in sacred Scripture, which is, of course, going to be picked up immediately in verses 3. Now, don't have time to elaborate, but when we come through the letter, well, notice when we get to 3:1, Paul says, what advantage does the Jew have then, given what I've just argued? He says, much in every way. They've been given the words. Or in 9:1-5, he longs for his own country folk, the Israelites, to whom has been given the original adoption as God's children, and the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, and the promises. It all belongs to them. Very important part of Romans is that it goes back to the ancient people. Now, when we turn to verses 3 and 4, Paul pauses now to express the content of the gospel, which we've already indicated is full of surprises. Notice that it begins that the gospel is about his son. And notice now God is still the sort of the subject of all of this. It's God's gospel that he promised, and what it's about is about God's son. Now, it begins with God's Son and ends with Jesus Christ our Lord. And then from that, he's going to launch into his apostleship, through whom I receive my gifting. But in the midst of all of this, that is, these God's Son and our Lord Jesus Christ, in between there are two clauses that are extremely important and need to be heard carefully. By the way, there's an enormous literature on these two verses. I think the bibliography is something like 25 to 30 articles just on these two verses alone in the immense literature on Romans. Part of it because people think that it's an early creed, and I'm altogether unimpressed by that because this is so full of Pauline things that I can't imagine. If my way of talking about these to my pan-creedalist friends, that is, who find creeds everywhere in Paul, is that the upshot of it all is that they're all so different and they're all so Pauline that if they are creeds, and I don't have any trouble with the fact that some of them might be, if they are creeds, Paul wrote them all himself. I mean, they're Pauline creeds. But in any case, verse 3 speaks to Christ being the Jewish Messiah. And verse 4 speaks to his being Son of God with power. And what holds them together is the contrast between on the one hand katasarka, on the other hand katapneuma. One's according to the flesh, meaning in his human life, and the other is katapneuma, meaning in his present existence in the realm of the spirit. Now the key to all of this lies, first of all, in verse 2. The gospel had been promised through the prophets in Holy Scripture. Now, does anybody have any idea what the key prophetic text in Holy Scripture is that Paul is now about to elaborate or spell out? Okay, because to miss this is actually to miss what's going on. He really does intend that God promised through the prophets in Holy Scripture. Now we turn back and ask, what promise through a prophet in Holy Scripture? And the answer is 2 Samuel 7, verses 12 to 15. This is the oracle of Nathan to David. When David wants to build a temple, and he starts to make the preparations, and God sends Nathan to tell him, no, you can't do it. And in the midst of that oracle from Nathan to David, we have these words that begin in verse 12. Now listen to the language. I will raise up for you seed to succeed you, and I will establish his kingdom. I will be his father, and he will be my son. Now you can hardly miss what's kind of this text. This is a Christian expression of the fulfillment of what God spoke to David through Nathan that had to do with his seed having an eternal reign and being God's son. Now, all of that is messianic, you understand, in its origins. That is messianic, not in its true origins, but as it came to be understood in the history of Israel. This is where messianism begins in Israel, is the prophetic oracle of Nathan to David that David's seed will have a kingdom that doesn't end and that the king will be known as God's son. That's why the coronation hymn of Psalm 2 is so important in Jewish history and stands as the second psalm in the Psalter to sort of, the first and the second psalms, you understand, are the two psalms that are the heading psalms for the whole Psalter, and the vast majority of the Psalter has to do with the royal kingship of David. It's about the Davidic king. You are my son. This day I have begotten you. This is sung at the coronation of the kings of Israel, based on this promise in 2 Samuel 7. Well, now listen to how Paul puts it. He says, promised beforehand through the prophets and the Holy Scriptures concerning his son. Now, obviously we're going to understand son in a new way, as belonging to God in a Trinitarian way, not spelled out yet in Paul in what I call all the Trinitarian implications, but clearly Trinitarian. That's a step beyond, but the point is, the one who is that son is none other than the Jewish Messiah. If you don't mind my putting it, this is Paul's way of doing exactly what John does at the end of his gospel when he says many other signs he did that are not written in this book, but these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. You understand? Those two are absolutely crucial to their understanding. Son of God, therefore, first of all, being a messianic title. I will be his father, he will be my son, you are my son. We're not thinking in terms of you know, the deity of the second person of the Trinity, not in those passages. But finally it turns out, yeah, that's what he's been talking about all along. It just hasn't been revealed yet. No Jew is understanding these passages, you understand, in Trinitarian terms. They're understanding it strictly in messianic terms. Then Christ comes along and is revealed, and now we not only hear the messianism of all of that, but we understand who it is that is really the Son. So it's concerning his Son. So verse 3 makes sure, and notice how it's that who was of the seed of David in terms of his human life. So that's what ties it, the Son, the seed. And of course in Galatians, Paul has already argued much of this. So the seed of David, according to him, but his present position, and he's going to position Christ in the heavens, you understand, in Romans 8:34, he says, Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father making intercession for us. That's, by the way, the language that comes out of Psalm 110, where the exalted one is at the right hand of the glory of God. So what you have is, according to his earthly life, he belongs to the seed of David. He belongs to that promised Messiah. He is the Jewish Messiah. Don't mistake that. And that's important for Paul. But then he goes on to say that his subsequent sonship, that is, that which follows on his earthly life, he has been declared to be Son of God with power. And you understand that en dunami, and I think that's what the NIV, you can already anticipate my arguing with the committee on this one, who through the Spirit of holiness was declared with power. I think not only does the context, but the word order just screams that the with power goes with Son of God. He's declared Son of God with power. No longer seed of David according to the flesh, but Son of God with power. How that? In keeping with the Spirit of holiness, which is a Old Testament periphrasis for the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of holiness. And how does he enter into this Son of God with power? Through the resurrection of the dead. That is, this is eschatological language. From the time or on the basis of his resurrection, he has entered into his true sonship, as it were, in terms of his present reign at the right hand of God. And that's what the gospel is about. It's about the Jewish Messiah who is Son of God with power. Now, it's this Son, the Son of God with power, not made to be so, but clearly appointed or declared to be so on the basis of the resurrection of the dead, it's this one who is now, and the flow of thought comes back to Paul's apostleship. It's through him that I've received this grace and apostleship. Now, we've got to skip over some things. The phrase that's crucial to us, of course, is the obedience of faith, which probably doesn't mean obedience to the gospel, but rather means obedience that is related to one's having faith in Christ. That is, it's the obedience that is expression of one's faith. A lot of debate there, but not going into the details. That's probably how we're to understand that. The obedience that comes out of one's faithful relationship to Christ. And, of course, crucial to Paul's understanding of his existence is that he is an apostle to the Gentiles. We move down to verse 7, and I'm doing this now a bit more quickly than I would have liked, but we need to get to the next section as well. The address itself, we need to just make quick note of. He addresses all those in Rome. Now, I think that's emphatic. I think that's the beginning point where we're going to begin to see what finally concludes in 15:7-13, namely Jew and Gentile together, glorifying God with one voice, to all of those in Rome. Now, the majority of those who are working on Romans right now would tend to take that stance. Where we will differ is whether the emphasis is to Jews to include Gentiles or Gentiles to include Jews, or maybe it just really is both, and we need to learn to try to read it that way. But in any case, it's to all of those in Rome. Now, I grant you, Paul does the same thing in Philippians, where he repeats the all at least five times in these first three or four verses. But it's very clear that the reason for it in Philippians is because some people in the church are not getting along, and that one of the main reasons for the letter is they're being united into one mind in Christ. So it's just all everywhere. Well, the same thing is true here, all. Now, he begins, and just... this stuff is just so full of theology. It's just... I mean, he mentions them, all of those who are in Rome. And he doesn't begin by saying something about, you know, the saints, all the saints in Rome. What he says is all of those who are in Rome. And then he defines them in two ways. They are, first of all, beloved by God. And what we're going to find out as we read this letter, that what lies behind everything that has to do with the gospel is the fact that God's character is love, and it's God's love that makes all of this happen. We've heard that so many times in our lives that sometimes, you know, that just sort of bounces off us. But not for Paul. It's that God loves you. That's why you're his people. But in his loving you, he called you to be his holy people. I have to say a word about saints, because in Pauline usage, we can cut through an enormous amount of stuff by just noting two passages in the Old Testament. First, in Exodus 19:6, at the beginning of the covenant on Mount Sinai, when God speaks through Moses to the people, he says that I have taken you out of slavery and made you, and then he uses this language, to be my holy people, my holy ones, my holy people, a holy priesthood. That language is then picked up in among the Jews, but where it's really picked up most significantly, to say we can cut through all the rest of it, is a passage in Daniel 7:27, where in this particular Danielic vision, he says that the kingdom will be given to the saints, the people of the Most High. And what's crucial, you understand, is that this is an eschatological designation of the people of God. That is, this whole Danielic vision is an eschatological vision about the future, about the coming of the Messiah and the Messiah's people. And the Messiah's people in the eschatological age that Daniel refers to are called the saints of the Most High. And that is exactly where Paul picks up the language. This is a clearly eschatological designation of the people of God. They belong, they are the people of God who belong to the future. They are God's saints of the Most High. The ones who belong to God, called to be those who belong to the Messiah, who belong to the Son of Man who appears before the Ancient of Days, whose kingdom is forever. The ones who belong to him are the saints of the Most High. That's why Paul uses this language. They belong to God. And then, of course, he says to them, and I preached from this last Sunday, so I don't dare do it today, the same text, but in Philippians, grace to you and peace. And this, of course, is the combination of the Greek greeting with the Hebrew. The Greek greeting is kairein, which just means greetings. Paul has changed kairein to charis, same root, only one letter changed. Greetings becomes grace, and then he picks up the Jewish shalom. But notice that it's always in this order, and you notice that I've changed the order of the NIV. I don't even try to effect a change in the English, because grace and peace to you is the only way it will ever be read. But it reads in Paul, grace to you and peace. Always in that order, grace to you and peace. In a way, this is a compendium of Pauline theology. Peace means shalom, of course. It doesn't mean just the well-arranged heart. It means shalom in the community, a people of shalom. And the way that they come to being a people of shalom is grace. Grace to you. And the source is God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And listen to the high Christology in that. Grace to you and peace. God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ in one prepositional phrase. That is, it doesn't say from God and from Christ. It's from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. One preposition holding the two together. It's one of those, what I call incidental moments of very high Christology that many people overlook. Just God and Christ together, responsible for the grace. Now, very quickly, some things out of the next section that I want to just make note of. We've already noted the stuff in verse 8. Verse 9, I just want to call attention that God is my witness, whom I serve. Paul does this several times in his letters when he wants to stress a point. The thing that makes it so highly unusual here, of course, is that it breaks the thanksgiving and the prayer apart. But he feels this kind of compulsion that they understand that God will be the one bearing witness to the fact that he does, in fact, remember them all the time in prayer and give thanks for them. I think we have to take seriously that Paul does this, that he constantly praise and gives thanks for people all the time, even those who are not his own converts. Well, I want to skip to verse 11 in particular, because we've already noted Paul wants to impart some spiritual gift. This is the only place in the Pauline corpus where we have this combination of charisma pneumatikon. I mentioned this the other day. Charisma by itself does not mean spiritual gift. It means some concrete expression of grace. Even in our letter, 6:23, the charisma of God is eternal life. It just means that this is the expression of grace in the world is eternal life. In 11:29, he uses the word about the privileges granted, the gifts of God, the charismata of God that are granted to Israel. 2 Corinthians 1:11, it's a specific deliverance from death. And 1 Corinthians 7:7, it's celibacy and marriage. I mean, the word doesn't mean spiritual gift. It means a concrete expression of grace. It comes to be called spiritual gift because in 1 Corinthians 12, it's the word Paul uses to speak to those specific manifestations of the Spirit that are manifestations of grace in their midst. But charisma doesn't mean spiritual gift. Charisma has to do with the gracious thing that God is doing by the Holy Spirit in their midst. So you have this gracious gifting. It's when he adds pneumatikon to it. That's when it becomes spiritual gift, because pneumatikon is an adjective that means belonging to the Spirit, pertaining to the Holy Spirit. Now, an awful lot of confusion and frankly, bad exegesis has taken place on this passage in Romans, because we read this in light of 1 Corinthians 12, and then we ask, what spiritual gift did he want to impart? You know, tongues, prophecy? No! Come on. It's some gifting of the Spirit, some gracious gifting of the Spirit that Paul wants to impart to them. And I think in this case, it's the Spirit, it's the prophetic ministry that he's been given for the church that he's going to elaborate in Romans. If you will, Romans becomes this spiritual gift. But the thing that fascinates is verse 12, where having said that this is what he wanted to do, impart some spiritual gift in order to strengthen you, he backs up and says, that is, what I really mean is that we might be mutually encouraged by one another's faith. And that's the clear recognition that we're not talking apostle. That is, that we're not talking client, patron-client relationship, to use the sociological terms of antiquity. It's not patron-client, it's mutuality. He's going to speak into their midst authoritatively because of his calling, because of who he is. But when he gets there, he expects it to be a mutual encouraging, because they both have faith in Christ Jesus. And then he goes on to indicate how he's wanted to come, but he couldn't, that he's a debtor to all. And that's what leads then directly into verse 16. Now, I think what we're going to do, and I think we need to do it today, is I'm going to go ahead and start with verses 16 and 17 when we pick up the rest of chapter 1. Partly because there is so much that's important in that text that we need to look at as anticipating an awful lot of things in the rest of the letter. So it's clearly a transitional sentence. That is, it's transitional in that it brings the thanksgiving to conclusion. It really does belong to the thanksgiving and prayer. But as a matter of fact, its content clearly serves as the heading for what follows. So we'll come back to it and speak to it then as at the heading of the material for next time. Gracious God, thank you for this morning. Thank you for the joy of your presence. Thank you for the gospel, your gospel, that comes through our Lord Jesus Christ and is appropriated in our lives by the Holy Spirit. We bless you and honor you. We pray your presence with us this morning as we think together about this text. For Christ's sake. Amen. It is easy to start one's study of Romans at 1:16, since for most people that's where the argument begins. We have a rather truncated way of doing Romans in the church, and for most people, Romans begins at 1:16. It is of some interest that, of course, that sentence is dependent upon verse 15, that it's not an independent sentence that begins something, but it is an explanatory sentence coming out of verses 14 and 15. In any case, to start at 1:16 is to miss far too much. Not only because so many hints as to purpose and concern emerge in verses 1 to 17, but also, as I've already indicated, verses 16 and 17 themselves so clearly belong to verses 14 and 15, which in turn are closely linked to verses 10 to 13. But as with so much in this letter, this opening material is full of surprises. The form is easy enough. As with most of Paul's letters, it has the very straightforward form of the three-part salutation. Paul, to believers in Rome, greetings. But Paul's letters simply begin this way. Paul, usually something about himself, which is standard here, to those who are in Rome, a couple of things about them, and then grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ is found in that form in, what, 8 of the 10 letters written to churches. Well, the 10 letters other than the pastorals, which then would include Philemon. And although Philemon is addressed to Philemon, it's also, of course, addressed to the church in Colossae. So that's very standard stuff. And then, of course, it's followed immediately by a thanksgiving and prayer report. I thank my God for all of you as I unceasingly pray for you. I mean, just simply lift those materials out. If you put it another way, if you were to simply lift out verses 1, 7, 8 and 10, you would have the absolutely standard Pauline prescript to his letter. Three-part salutation, thanksgiving, and prayer, and sometimes, of course, a prayer report. Now, as with most of Paul's letters, these various items sometimes are elaborated. The surprise in Romans is not only the nature and length of one of these elaborations, but also the nature of the second one. That is, a considerable elaboration that takes place in the salutation, the three-part salutation. And then there's another considerable elaboration in the Thanksgiving prayer report. So that when we finally get into the middle of that prayer report, you get the feeling that the prayer, that this is no longer the content of his prayer. Something has obviously happened as he's reporting on his praying for them and what it is he prays, and then he goes on to make a considerable explanation of that. And it's that explanation about his praying that finally then evolves into another explanatory sentence, verses 16 and 17, which most people recognize functions in some way as the or at least an introductory theme to Romans. A little reluctant to call it the theme of Romans. It certainly sets Romans in perspective, but it doesn't cover all the ground. But in any case, it's sort of an introductory thematic sentence. So the fact that we have this standard stuff, as I say, if you just had verses 1, 7, 8, and 10, we would begin with verse 16. As we'd make a few comments on those, but we would get over that quickly and get on with verse 16. But it's the fact that he elaborates, which is of course not a surprise, but the what and the nature of that of those elaborations that give us reason to pause. Now, to get at all of this, let's begin by noting the pure forms, which, when I say pure, that's in quotes for me, the pure forms are already Paulinized. That is, Paul has already touched a standard kind of formulation. The salutation, verses 1 to 7. I've already noted that the pure form is found in verses 1 and 7. Paul, servant or slave of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle. Sometimes that comes out slightly differently. This is the only place, in fact, where we have the double designation. Slave of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle. But nothing unusual there. Usually he says apostle through the will of God or the command of God or something like that, which isn't here. Skip down to verse 7. Those who are in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints. Nothing surprising or unusual there. We'll make a note of that when we come to it in a moment. And then, of course, grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. But the bulk of this material, verses 1 to 7, and I'm thinking now of the Greek text. There are 12 lines in the standard Greek text. And I'm counting lines in the Nestle-Aland Greek text. Of the 12 lines of this text, 8 of them are given over to a very considerable elaboration of what it means for Paul to be called to be an apostle. And even that, what it means for him to be called to be an apostle, really only emerges down here in verse 5, which then is picked up a bit in an elaborate way, which has to do with what it means for him to be an apostle to the Gentiles, and hence his reason for writing to Rome. But before we get to that, what we have is an elaboration of the gospel, which also is very unusual. First of all, because it focuses on the gospel itself, but in this case, not as in the rest of Romans, not in terms of what the gospel is or what the gospel does, but in terms of who the gospel is about. It's a highly unusual moment in Paul, actually. That is, ordinarily when Paul starts to say something about the gospel, his instincts are to say something about what the gospel does. But in this case, you can read it through. There's nothing about how the gospel is effective in people's lives or what God is doing in the gospel with regard to salvation. I mean, quite different, you see, from verse 16. I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation. I mean, that's what we expect when Paul elaborates on the gospel, but quite different here. That's, in fact, the surprise factor in this opening passage. Given how Romans falls out, what is going on in these verses 2 to 6, especially verses 2 to 4? The only other place Paul does anything quite like this in his salutations is in Galatians. In that case, the elaboration takes place after the salutation proper, where he says, "Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who..." And then he has this considerable sentence with regard to Christ. But different from this one, which has to do with something about Christ himself, the one in Galatians goes like this: "Who gave himself for our sins so that he might rescue us from this present evil age." Clearly the interest is in salvation in Christ. That is, that the interest in Christ is in the saving work of Christ, not on who Christ is in that case. So we have this, first of all, this interesting thing that happens in this case. The second thing Paul does in the elaboration is to focus on his own role in the gospel, and here with special emphasis on his being an apostle. It comes out first in verse 1. His being called to be an apostle is immediately qualified in terms of his having been set apart with regard to the gospel. And then after this elaboration about the gospel itself, in verse 5 he returns to his calling and apostleship, which focuses first of all on the sphere of his endeavor, namely all the Gentiles, and then the purpose of his apostleship, which is the obedience of faith on the part of all the Gentiles. Now, obviously, we'll have to come back to all of these things. I'm just at this point And I'll do this on a regular basis, just simply go through an overview of the whole section that we're dealing with. And then we'll come back and look at some of the details that as we look at the nature of the argumentation of the whole, and this, of course, is not argumentation, but in effect it is. We look at the nature of the argumentation as a whole and see what it is he's doing and how it's working. Then we'll come back and look at some of the details as we have time. Now, I want to just note finally that he concludes the elaboration by including the believers in Rome, which tells us, first, that he perceives the congregation as primarily Gentile. I mean, if you were to read this salutation, you would not think that there are any Jews present at all. And secondly, that what he is doing is undoubtedly his delicate way of justifying such a long letter to a group of believers who are not his and therefore are not related to his apostolic authority. That is, notice how it goes. His own calling and apostleship is for the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles. And once he's made that point, then he says, among whom also you. So it's the very fact that his apostleship is for all the Gentiles that gives him the authority to write to the church in Rome that is not one of his own. Because you are among the Gentiles. I mean, that's how he's pulling this off. So my apostleship has to do with the gospel, Christ. It has to do with bringing the gospel, which brings obedience on the basis of faith, to all the Gentiles. And then, of course, among all the Gentiles, you are to be included. So, and then, of course, he says something more about them. Now, it shouldn't take any particularly deep insight to recognize that this is a highly unusual moment in Paul and needs some explanation, part of which will be forthcoming in the next matter, the Thanksgiving and Prayer Report, which begins in verse 8. And as we look at that next now, we'll see that part of our explanation for what's going on in verses 1 to 7 is going to be helped by looking at this next section, which I couldn't get onto. Now, as with the salutation, the introductory matters, the thanksgiving is absolutely standard Paul. Verse 8. It comes to us in three parts. First, there's the statement of thanksgiving itself. I thank my God. He ordinarily says, I thank God. This is the first of his letters in which he says, I thank my God. And then he does this again in Philippians and Philemon. So apparently this is something that begins to develop in the later parts of his ministry. But it's standard stuff. I thank my God. The unusual expansion through Jesus Christ. We'll come back and say a bit a few minutes later. But just to recognize how standard this is. The second, of course, is the focus of the thanksgiving, which is always for the people themselves. I thank my God for all of you. How radically different from most of our praying and thanking. We tend to thank God for things and events. Paul's thanksgivings invariably are for people. I thank my God for all of you. Now, very often, not always, but very often in his thanksgiving, then he will also give a reason for his thanking God for them. Take Philippians, for example. I thank my God for all of you, every prayer of mine, mentioning you in my prayer, for your koinonia in the gospel from the beginning until now. So that's the basis for the thanksgiving. Thanksgiving is for them, but in the thanksgiving and praying, he's reminded of their long history of partnership with him in the gospel. So here we have the same thing, the reason for the thanksgiving. That he would do so is certainly standard, but how he expresses it in this case is where the surprises begin now in this letter. Not altogether, but somewhat. It's the only other place something like this happens is in 1 Thessalonians. Namely, he thanks God that their faith is being announced all over the world. Before I write to you, I have already been in prayer and thanksgiving for you because your faith is simply being noted everywhere. The whole world. Well, at least in the world that Paul knows. He knows, he's continually getting reports about the church in Rome. Now, the same thing is true, that is the standard stuff, the same thing is true with the prayer report. The form is quite standard. In this case, it picks up at the end of verse 9. I continually mention you, always in my prayers, requesting. It's a bit of an awkward thing. It's a compounding of mentioning them. That is, he compounds the fact that he does this unceasingly and always. That happens elsewhere, by the way. Unceasingly mentioning you, always in my prayers. This is the way it tends to go. So, nothing about that that's strange at all. But the content of the prayer is where all of the surprise comes and begins to offer all kinds of further clues about the letter. For indeed, the most remarkable thing about this section of the material, and it's remarkable in that you look at all the rest of Paul's thanksgivings and prayers that begin the letters, and invariably he prays for them in some way. But the moment he starts to talk, and he says he mentions them in prayer, and that means he does pray for them. That is, as he gives the point that needs to be noted, and we'll not come back to that, so we'll note it here, is that these sentences are broken up in this case, but in every other case the sentences go together, that Paul's thanksgiving takes place in the context of his praying. A very, very important point to make. His praying is not separated from his thanksgiving. A part of his praying for them is thanksgiving for them. Simply the way that's the way he is. In this case, it gets broken up by this little insertion of this oath, God is my witness. That itself is striking and stunning. But when he gets to the prayer, we just take the little oath out for a minute. You've got, I give thanks to God through Christ Jesus, mentioning you always in my praying. It finally comes down to it, in verse 9b, mentioning you always in my praying. Then what you expect is for him to say something about what it is that he prays about them. And instead, what we get in this case is that his prayer has to do with his coming to see them. Now, that's prayer for them in an indirect way. But it has to do with not just praying for them and, if you will, their needs and what's going on. And it's undoubtedly that he intends that when he begins the praying, when he mentions every mention of you. It's hard to imagine that his prayer does not include the very things he's going to write about in this letter. It's hard to imagine that that's not true. But right in the middle of this sentence, what gets into focus for Paul is as he prays for these people who are not his converts, but he prays for them on an ongoing basis. His concern is his relationship with them. That's already been hinted at back in verses 5 and 6 in that unusual moment in the salutation. And now, everything focuses on his relationship with them, which, of course, up to this point hasn't existed. So what he's focusing on is his hoped-for relationship with them. So it's his desire to visit them that becomes the content of the prayer. Now, what happens then is that he elaborates now, this, as he did in the earlier part, and the elaboration, which in the first case gives thanks for their faith that is becoming universally known. Paul does this elsewhere. 1 Thessalonians 1, 7, 2 Thessalonians 1, 3, he thanks God for their faith, and then that faith is known in some way, Colossians 1, 4. But in this case, where Paul sometimes gives thanks for their faith, which usually needs to be understood as faith / faithfulness, that is, it's not just their initial trust in Christ, you understand, it's their ongoing trust in Him. Faith becomes faithfulness. The fruit of the Spirit is faith. Paul does not mean their saving faith. He means ongoing trust, faithfulness. It gets translated that way in your English Bibles. The fruit of the Spirit is faithfulness. The word is faith. I mean, it's what he's thanking God for, is their faith. But in this case, that their faith or faithfulness, faithful trust in Christ, is known everywhere. Now, here, if you will, is the tacit acknowledgement that they're an established congregation. And as we will learn momentarily, that he has had nothing at all to do with their coming to faith. Again, an apparent recognition on his part of the unusual nature. And as I say, a recognition on his part of the unusual nature of this letter. I mean, the moment you start getting into the letter and read it in light of all the rest of his letters, you recognize that he himself recognizes there's an unusual, you know, what he's doing is unusual for him. He's not used to doing this. He doesn't usually write to churches that are not his own. And it's trying to get at that, you know, as you, if you will, to establish the basis for their hearing him out. I need to put by way of parenthesis here, because we'll come back to it from time to time, but Paul very clearly understands his letters to take the place of his personal presence. And he also understands his letters to therefore be a prophetic word, that is, a word from the Holy Spirit that is being prophetically spoken into their midst. And that can be established on a whole lot of grounds, but there's very little question of that. That is, and therefore you need to understand and you need to hear well. The fact is that this is going to be read in church. And it's not going to be read as missionary letters are read in our churches or something like that. It's going to be read in church in the same way that Scripture is read in church. It's a very important point to make. People ask, where does canonical authority come from in the Pauline letters or the apostolic letters? And I'll tell you, it comes from the fact that their very first reading takes place in church in the context of a situation where the only other thing that's read in church is Scripture. I mean, it's very authoritative kind of thing going on. Yes, David.
Why would they receive that this way? Is this tradition?
Well, when you say canonical authority, of course, that's putting it backwards. But what earns him his hearing, of course, in all of his other letters. I mean, if he only had Romans, that becomes, as I say, that's what makes Romans such an interesting moment for us. Because the rest of his letters, the authority is that he is an apostle of Jesus Christ to the people who are receiving the letter. And therefore, he speaks into their midst. My sentences to you were carefully put in order. He understands his letters to take the place of his personal presence. And when he's present among them, he speaks authoritatively in their midst. So he is. He's the apostle, called to be an apostle through Christ Jesus. So the fact that he does this when he's present with them personally, he understands his letters to take the place of his personal presence. It's just, there's all kinds of evidence that we can show that this is so. That's why in 1 Corinthians, for example, when Paul says, and when you assemble together, and my spirit is present, he means I'm present by the Holy Spirit. In that context, and of course it means in the context of their reading that letter right at that point, they are to turn this man over to Satan. I mean, that's, the authority lies in the fact that when they assemble together the power of the Lord Jesus and Paul is present in the letter, the Spirit of God is present speaking through Paul in that letter, they're to act. It's very strong kind of authoritative stuff. It's same is true in Philippians. It's going to be read in church as a word to the community that comes from the Spirit through Paul. So out of that, the very fact that that happens means that they probably read these letters again and again when Paul isn't present. And you understand, what finally makes the canon develop the way it does is two things. Namely, is it apostolic in some way or another? And is it read in church? Because what's read in church is Scripture. Simple as that. And what isn't read in church isn't Scripture. This is why the Muratorian canon can tell them, urge them to read the Shepherd of Hermas, but not in church. Because the moment they read it in church, that gives it canonical authority. So it's the reading in church that finally establishes the canonicity of these materials. And people who think, well, you know, the church is sort of you know, in a kind of accidental historical way, ended up with these letters. Well, that's not quite true. These letters are preserved and read in the churches precisely because they're read in church at the very beginning as an authoritative prophetic word into their midst. Now, not all of the letters that Paul wrote apparently were kept in that way, but many of them were. We have those. Now, my point is, back to this particular letter, is that it's fun to watch what Paul is doing here, because whereas he would speak in a quite different way to one of his own churches, here is a certain sense in which he's, in a sense, trying to justify their reading this in church. What's going to cause them to do it? Of course, when I say read in church, don't think of one of our churches with 500 seats and somebody, you know what I'm saying? We're thinking of house churches and in the context of their gathering. What I would like to know, what caused all of this to come about, as I was thinking about all of this in the process of the lecture, is that this letter is going to be a long one, and is it going to be read all at one time? The answer is probably yes. I'm not going to simply read it through. And you say, how could they have done it? Well, the answer is very simple. The difference between them and us is so severe at this point that it's almost impossible for us to ever enter into their minds. And it's the difference between what I call a basically oral culture and a basically literary culture. Ours is a basically literary culture. And I say ours, I mean Western civilization and all Asian civilizations that have been deeply impacted by the West. Basically literary cultures. Most people read and write. Our thinking is what's written, to read. And when we think read by ourselves, silently. People didn't begin to read silently until somewhere in the 16th century. Everybody read aloud when they were by themselves. Reading was an oral expression from the very beginning. Everybody read aloud. And in a culture where the minority read, you understand, somebody is reading for the rest to hear. You listen to the Revelation, how it begins, where he says, blessed is the one who reads this and those who hear. Man, I know what 20th century Westerns do with that. They think in terms of reading it privately and then hearing it preached in church. No! The blessing is upon the reader of the text as it's being read as a prophetic word, and the hearers to hear it as the prophetic word. There's a clear evidence of what's going on in these kinds of texts. But you understand that the great advantage they had over us is precisely because for us it's written in a book and we can always go back and consult the book. We don't have to ever remember anything. And most of us have very, very poor memories. We do some rote stuff to pass exams. But we don't have good memories in the sense of when we hear something, we have it. You get into any oral culture where truth is transmitted by stories. And some of you come from those kinds of cultures where, I think, for example, in India, where a great number of people in much of the culture are still going to transmit their truths by story. The ability to remember and to repeat is incredibly higher than ours. We've just sublimated all of that stuff because we can consult the book. So yeah, they're going to read the whole thing in church. It's going to be a long sitting, but it's all right. They probably read an awful lot of the Old Testament at one sitting. And they know it well. That's why all this argument in Romans that is to a primarily Gentile church is full of Scripture. Because they know the Scriptures better than you do. I'm prepared to say that they know it better than you do, even if you're an Old Testament major. They just know it because they hear it read all the time. It's a part of their whole life. So this is going to be read. Well, that is a bit of a digression, but it has something to do with the fact that this is going to be read in the churches, in the house churches in Rome. And Paul knows that. And it's anticipation of that, the fact that they're not his own converts. So his prayer for them has been of this, not of the usual kind, but of this rather unusual kind. Now, point then is that this material is full of items that call for our attention. First, that it begins with an oath formula in verse 9 is especially noteworthy. I mean, why would Paul say, God is my witness about Paul, about the fact that I pray for you all the time? And the oath formula comes by way of a gar, that is, by way of a for God is my witness. That is, it comes by way of explanation, an explanation that requires some missing links to be filled in, very frankly. The very fact that he says for and then has the oath just calls for our filling out some missing links in here. And I think it goes something like this: their faith is world-renowned. Then he goes, for God is my witness. How that in praying for you I continually request that. And then he goes on. The connections between all of these things are not immediately visible. Now, what are the missing links? Well, probably, first, that they're already an established church, and Paul knows that. And secondly, that he has had nothing to do with their being established. Yet, and now this is what's going on, they are not thereby any less related to him in Christ. That is, even though they are not his converts, they are still his in the broader relational sense of being in Christ. And furthermore, and this now becomes part of the letter to Romans, it's the capital, because of their significance in the capital of the empire, he longs to have had a part in their coming to faith, but in any case, since he did not, he still wants to have a part in who they are in Christ. So what's happening is that here's a church that's already well established. He and they belong to one another by virtue of their relationship to Christ. It's quite clear by what he says in verses 13, 14, 15. He would have liked to have had a part in their becoming who they are. I mean, he makes no bones of that. But since he didn't have a part in their becoming who they are, he still would like to have a part in them. And that's why he's now going to write the letter. And that's what he's going to go on and explain in verses 13 to 15. Now, so that brings me to verse 11. I mean, the reason he's wanted to come to them is that he might impart some spiritual gift, that you might be strengthened. Now, first of all, that's obvious that's a church that's already established. They're already established, but he wants to impart some spiritual gift that they may be strengthened. Now, as I suggested last time, I would dare to propose that we must take this seriously as a primary reason for the letter. That is, the letter is going to function as that spiritual gift for them to be strengthened. But after the proper disclaimer in verse 12, which we'll come back to, he picks this theme up again in verse 13b, that I may have some fruit among you, even as among the rest of the Gentile world. And that's picked up then again in verse 15 in terms of his being a debtor to all Gentiles of all kinds. And it's in that context he says, it has been my desire to preach the gospel also to you in Rome. And it's that final sentence, his being debtor to all Gentiles and the desire to preach the gospel in Rome, that serves as the lead-in to what he wants to say in the letter itself, and thus the lead-in to verses 16 and 17. And once we get to verses 16 and 17, all kinds of things differ. I do these structural analyses and color them, but in my color scheme, the blue is always the Apostle Paul, and green is always, in some way, the people to whom he's writing. It doesn't take very long. Let's skip back through. And all the way down, it's until you get down to verse 6 that you have any green at all, and then you have the stand. So all the way down here, but there's not much about Paul. Verse 1 and then again verse 5. So the elaborations take place outside of Paul and the Romans themselves. Well, then, come to verses 8 to 12, and you'll notice now the mixture of blue and green. It's all about Paul, and that's what dominates this material. And the same is true when you come down to verses 14 following. It's still dominated by this I and you, this relational stuff between them. It just dominates. That gives you a clue, by the way. This little color scheme is just a way of stepping back and looking at the text and seeing what makes up most of the stuff? What's the content mostly about? It's always an eye catcher for me. It highlights some things. Just help me to see what's going on in the text. But then the moment you get to verse 16, all of that changes. Paul says, I'm not ashamed, but everything then has to do with the gospel and Christ and the gospel and God and the one who believes, which is now a more universal kind of thing and not directed specifically toward any one person, the church in Rome. Well, this final thing, verse 16 and 17, clearly starts. I mean, everybody recognizes it. It's all been called the theme of Romans, and I quite agree. In many ways, that's true. But what you need to recognize is how he gets there. He gets there by verse 15. My desire has been to preach the gospel even among those of you who are in Rome, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel. You understand? That's how it works. Now, this is where he's been wanting to get to all along. And it took him all the rest of this material in order to get there. Now, I want us to go back now and look at some of this material in a bit of detail. Now, I want to say a few things about verse 1. This is the only instance of the double identification I've already indicated, doulos of Christ Jesus. Now, it is of some interest to me that he begins that way. In all of the letters written to his churches, let me back that up. There is no identification at all in 1 and 2 Thessalonians. It's almost the certain evidence that they're the earliest of the two of the Pauline letters. Those letters are simply Paul and Silas and Timothy to the church in Thessalonica. And then even the salutation in the first one is not complete. It's grace and peace to you, that's all. But once you get past 1 and 2 Thessalonians, then you have some stuff that becomes standard in Paul. And in that standard stuff, beginning with 1 Corinthians, Paul always identifies himself as an apostle, with the one exception of Philippians. The reason for it, of course, in Philippians is that that's a letter of friendship, and the relationship is not apostle and converts, but those who have been in partnership with him in the gospel all of his life. So he writes to them and identifies himself with this phrase, servant or slave of Christ Jesus. Now, that's the one he begins with in Romans, slave of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle. And you'll notice that even about the apostleship, he repeats the thing he does in 1 Corinthians, that his apostleship is a calling. That is, he immediately focuses the direction toward God, that his apostleship is God's calling, or Christ's calling, whichever. And that what he is as an apostle is a doulos of Christ Jesus. Now, the problem, of course, is translating doulos. Because the word means slave. And there's not a person, you're not a person in this culture who, hearing him say doulos, Jesu Christu, could have ever heard anything other than slave. You understand? They couldn't have heard anything else. But it's not quite as easy as that. This past summer in the NIV revision, we were working our way through Philippians and Galatians and some other Pauline letters. We had started Philippians the summer before and stopped with this word. And rather than get hung up on it, we commissioned two of our members of the committee to do a special study on the use of this so that we would come to terms with how to translate it. They gave a special study. They didn't agree together, and we spent 3 hours. It's not an easy one. In fact, this is a perfect illustration of the difficulty of translation. Because there are certain places where it is almost impossible to go from the original language into the receptor language and be able to find a dynamic equivalent. Now, the problem with slave in English is that the vast majority of speakers of English in first language, meaning both in Great Britain and in North America, have everything they hear in the word slave enculturated by the terrible evil of British American slavery. And I have to say British American because the slavery in the United States was the direct result of the British slave trade. It took William Wilberforce, a Christian, to bring that thing to its end. But everybody's understanding of slavery, that is not everybody's, but the majority of people, slave means that incredibly demeaning, dehumanizing experience out of North American history that those of us who are generations after are still embarrassed by and feel the need to weep and repent of our national evil. So the moment you say slave, you're already using a word that wouldn't have meant the same thing first century, because a slave in the first century, and especially in the time that Paul writes this letter, the vast majority of slaves by the time of Paul have been born of slave parents. That is, they're slaves by birth. And furthermore, slavery was not racial in the first century. And I say racial carefully. Most people who became slaves as the result of war. That is, conquest would bring people and they would just simply become slaves. The only other way people entered into slavery was actually by selling themselves. That is, they couldn't make it in a culture. Once the slavery gets going, you understand that's cheap labor, and so you have the very rich and then slaves, and there's the middle class just barely make their way through, and a lot of them don't make it, so they sold themselves into slavery. So it's a different kind of thing. I mean, I'm not saying that it's a good thing. It's still the bottom of the sociological pecking order, for sure. But many, many slaves who were given freedom continued to stay as attached freedmen in the house, so that there was, you know, it wasn't the dehumanizing thing. So the moment you say slave in English, how do you get back to their culture? Well, a part of the problem also for us, and here's the real problem, is that this is the word, doulos, is the word that was used by the Septuagint translators to translate the Hebrew eved many times, and in every case, when it says so-and-so was an eved Yahweh, so-and-so was a servant of the Lord. So Moses, the doulos of the Lord. Now, it came to be used then of people who are especially given to God in their lives. Moses, Daniel, can't remember, but there's about five or six of them, Joshua, the servant of the Lord, the servant of the Lord. Well, that doesn't mean the slave of the Lord. It means something closer to the servant of the Lord. So the problem, of course, now we're going to translate it. You translate it servant and you end up with something that loses an enormous amount of the impact that the word slave should have when we hear it. Namely, that these people are, in fact, belong to Christ. We're not just talking about, you know, those who can come and go and serve, but we're talking, you know, not just servant in some sort of casual way, but we're talking about someone who is the slave of Christ Jesus. Well, as I say, translation is nearly impossible, but the point for us here in this particular instance is that in approaching the Romans, that's the word he uses, slave of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle. Now, the moment he gets to that point, then he says, separated or set apart for the gospel of God, God's gospel. Now, Paul qualifies the word gospel in three ways. Six times he refers to my gospel, which he means something like the gospel I preach or the gospel as I preach it. Then 11 times he speaks of the gospel of Christ. And in this case, it's almost certainly an objective genitive, at least in most cases, meaning it's the gospel which has Christ as its content. But here, one of six times, he speaks of the gospel of God. And in this case, God is not the content of the gospel, but the source of the gospel. God's gospel. Now, the reason for saying that here is because I need to say this now about Romans. In many ways, Romans is all about God. And I say that because the word God appears more in Romans than in all of Paul's letters, almost all of them combined. Far more than Christ comes God in Romans. I mean, it's about God. It's about what God is doing. Now, he does it through Christ. But it starts that way, and you don't get very far away from that in this opening stuff. So, it's God's gospel, which, and now he's going to say something about this gospel, and that leads us then to verse 2. Now, verse 2 begins an elaboration of the gospel, noted in the overview, but he begins an emphasis that is crucial to Paul's present enterprise. And there are three points that are made. First, in saying that it has been, God promised it beforehand through the prophets in Holy Scripture, he's simply picking up the phrase, the gospel of God. God is not only the source of the gospel that Paul preaches, but he has already been at work in his ancient people. That is, what God is currently doing is something that's related to what he has been doing. Secondly, now about the whole elaboration, the gospel, which has Christ as its essential content, is first of all to be understood as the fulfillment of God's promises. God promised it beforehand. That is, it's not only that this is something that God is doing and it's related to something that God has been doing, but it's especially related to God's promises. Very important way Paul understands our Christian existence as the people of God is it belongs to the promise and a fulfillment. Now, this is eschatological language. It's the language of promise and fulfillment, and it's going to become key to what goes on in verses 3 and 4. Well, then third, the gospel is thus rooted, first of all, in what God did in his ancient people through the prophets in sacred scripture, which is, of course, going to be picked up immediately in verses 3. Now, don't have time to elaborate, but when we come through the letter, well, notice when we get to 3:1, Paul says, what advantage does the Jew have then, given what I've just argued? He says, much in every way. They've been given the words. Or in 9:1-5, he longs for his own country folk, the Israelites, to whom has been given the original adoption as God's children, and the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, and the promises. It all belongs to them. Very important part of Romans is that it goes back to the ancient people. Now, when we turn to verses 3 and 4, Paul pauses now to express the content of the gospel, which we've already indicated is full of surprises. Notice that it begins that the gospel is about his son. And notice now God is still the sort of the subject of all of this. It's God's gospel that he promised, and what it's about is about God's son. Now, it begins with God's Son and ends with Jesus Christ our Lord. And then from that, he's going to launch into his apostleship, through whom I received my gifting. But in the midst of all of this, that is, these God's Son and our Lord Jesus Christ, in between there are two clauses that are extremely important and need to be heard carefully. By the way, there's an enormous literature on these two verses. I think the bibliography is something like 25 to 30 articles just on these two verses alone in the immense literature on Romans. Part of it because people think that it's an early creed, and I'm altogether unimpressed by that because this is so full of Pauline things that I can't imagine. If my way of talking about these to my pan-creedalist friends, that is, who find creeds everywhere in Paul, is that the upshot of it all is that they're all so different and they're all so Pauline that if they are creeds, and I don't have any trouble with the fact that some of them might be, if they are creeds, Paul wrote them all himself. I mean, they're Pauline creeds. But in any case, verse 3 speaks to Christ being the Jewish Messiah. And verse 4 speaks to his being Son of God with power. And what holds them together is the contrast between, on the one hand, kata sarka, on the other hand, kata pneuma. One's according to the flesh, meaning in his human life, and the other is kata pneuma, meaning in his present existence in the realm of the Spirit. Now, the key to all of this lies, first of all, in verse 2. The gospel had been promised through the prophets in Holy Scripture. Now, does anybody have any idea what the key prophetic text in Holy Scripture is that Paul is now about to elaborate or spell out? Okay, because to miss this is actually to miss what's going on. He really does intend that God promised through the prophets in Holy Scripture. Now we turn back and ask, what promise through a prophet in Holy Scripture? And the answer is 2 Samuel 7, verses 12 to 15. This is the oracle of Nathan to David. When David wants to build a temple, and he starts to make the preparations, and God sends Nathan to tell him, no, you can't do it. And in the midst of that oracle from Nathan to David, we have these words that begin in verse 12. Now listen to the language. I will raise up for you seed to succeed you, and I will establish his kingdom. I will be his father, and he will be my son. Now you can hardly miss what's kind of this text. This is a Christian expression of the fulfillment of what God spoke to David through Nathan that had to do with his seed having an eternal reign and being God's son. Now, all of that is messianic, you understand, in its origins. That is messianic, not in its true origins, but as it came to be understood in the history of Israel. This is where messianism begins in Israel, is the prophetic oracle of Nathan to David, that David's seed will have a kingdom that doesn't end, and that the king will be known as God's son. That's why the coronation hymn of Psalm 2 is so important in Jewish history and stands as the second psalm in the Psalter to sort of, the first and the second psalms, you understand, are the two psalms that are the heading psalms for the whole Psalter. And the vast majority of the Psalter has to do with the royal kingship of David. It's about the Davidic king. You are my son. This day I have begotten you. This is sung at the coronation of the kings of Israel, based on this promise in 2 Samuel 7. Well, now listen to how Paul puts it. He says, promised beforehand through the prophets and the Holy Scriptures concerning his son. Now, obviously we're going to understand son in a new way, as belonging to God in a Trinitarian way, not spelled out yet in Paul in what I call all the Trinitarian implications, but clearly Trinitarian. That's a step beyond. But the point is, the one who is that son is none other than the Jewish Messiah. If you don't mind my putting it, this is Paul's way of doing exactly what John does at the end of his gospel when he says many other signs he did that are not written in this book, but these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. You understand? Those two are absolutely crucial to their understanding. Son of God, therefore, first of all, being a messianic title. I will be his father, he will be my son. You are my son. We're not thinking in terms of you know, the deity of the second person of the Trinity, not in those passages. But finally, it turns out, yeah, that's what he's been talking about all along. It just hasn't been revealed yet. No Jew is understanding these passages, you understand, in Trinitarian terms. They're understanding it strictly in Messianic terms. Then Christ comes along and is revealed, and now we not only hear the messianism of all of that, but we understand who it is that is really the Son. So it's concerning his Son. So verse 3 makes sure, and notice how it's that who was of the seed of David in terms of his human life. So that's what ties it, the son, the seed. And of course, in Galatians, Paul has already argued much of this. So the seed of David, according to human, but his present position, and he's going to position Christ in the heavens, you understand, in Romans 8, 34, he says, Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for us. That's, by the way, the language that comes out of Psalm 110, where the exalted one is at the right hand of the glory of God. So what you have is, according to his earthly life, he belongs to the seed of David. He belongs to that promised Messiah. He is the Jewish Messiah. Don't mistake that. And that's important for Paul. But then he goes on to say that his subsequent sonship, that is, that which follows on his earthly life, he has been declared to be Son of God with power. And you understand that en dunami, and I think that's what the NIV You can already anticipate my arguing with the committee on this one. Who through the Spirit of holiness was declared with power. I think not only does the context, but the word order just screams that the with power goes with Son of God. He's declared Son of God with power. No longer seed of David according to the flesh, but Son of God with power. How that? In keeping with the Spirit of holiness, which is an Old Testament periphrasis for the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of holiness. And how does he enter into this Son of God with power? Through the resurrection of the dead. That is, this is eschatological language. From the time or on the basis of his resurrection, he has entered into his true sonship, as it were, in terms of his present reign at the right hand of God. And that's what the gospel is about. It's about the Jewish Messiah who is Son of God with power. Now, it's this Son, the Son of God with power, made, not made to be so, but clearly appointed or declared to be so through on the basis of the resurrection of the dead, it's this one who is now, and the flow of thought comes back to Paul's apostleship. It's through him that I've received this grace and apostleship. Now, we've got to skip over some things. The phrase that's crucial to us, of course, is the obedience of faith, which probably doesn't mean obedience to the gospel, but rather means obedience that is related to one's having faith in Christ. That is, it's the obedience that is expression of one's faith. A lot of debate there, but not going into the details, that's probably how we're to understand that. The obedience that comes out of one's faithful relationship to Christ. And, of course, crucial to Paul's understanding of his existence is that he is an apostle to the Gentiles. We move down to verse 7, and I'm doing this now a bit more quickly than I would have liked, but we need to get to the next section as well. The address itself, we need to just make quick note of. He addresses all those in Rome. Now, I think that's emphatic. I think that's the beginning point where we're going to begin to see what finally concludes in 15:7-13, namely Jew and Gentile together, glorifying God with one voice, to all of those in Rome. Now, the majority of those who are working on Romans right now would tend to take that stance. Where we will differ is whether the emphasis is to Jews to include Gentiles or Gentiles to include Jews, or maybe it just really is both, and we need to learn to try to read it that way. But in any case, it's to all of those in Rome. Now, I grant you, Paul does the same thing in Philippians, where he repeats the all at least five times in these first three or four verses. But it's very clear that the reason for it in Philippians is because some people in the church are not getting along, and that one of the main reasons for the letter is they're being united in the one mind in Christ. So it's just all everywhere. Well, the same thing is true here, all. Now, he begins, this stuff is just so full of theology. He mentions them, all of those who are in Rome. And he doesn't begin by saying something about, they're the saints, all the saints in Rome. What he says is all of those who are in Rome. And then he defines them in two ways. They are, first of all, beloved by God. And what we're going to find out as we read this letter, that what lies behind everything that has to do with the gospel is the fact that God's character is love, and it's God's love that makes all of this happen. We've heard that so many times in our lives that sometimes, that just sort of bounces off us. But not for Paul. It's that God loves you. That's why you're his people. But in his loving you, he called you to be his holy people. I have to say a word about saints, because in Pauline usage, we can cut through an enormous amount of stuff by just noting two passages in the Old Testament. First, in Exodus 19:6, at the beginning of the covenant on Mount Sinai, when God speaks through Moses to the people, he says that I have taken you out of slavery and made you, and then he uses this language, to be my holy people, my holy ones, my holy people. a holy priesthood. That language is then picked up in among the Jews, but where it's really picked up most significantly, to say we can cut through all the rest of it, is a passage in Daniel 7:27, where in this particular Danielic vision, he says that the kingdom will be given to the saints, the people of the Most High. And what's crucial, you understand, is that this is an eschatological designation of the people of God. That is, this whole Danielic vision is an eschatological vision about the future, about the coming of the Messiah and the Messiah's people. And the Messiah's people in the eschatological age that Daniel refers to are called the saints of the Most High. And that is exactly where Paul picks up the language. This is a clearly eschatological designation of the people of God. They belong, they are the people of God who belong to the future. They are God's saints of the Most High. The ones who belong to God, called to be those who belong to the Messiah, who belong to the Son of Man who appears before the Ancient of Days, whose kingdom is forever. The ones who belong to Him are the saints of the Most High. That's why Paul uses this language. They belong to God. And then, of course, he says to them, and I preached from this last Sunday, so I don't dare do it today, the same text, but in Philippians, grace to you and peace. And this, of course, is the combination of the Greek greeting with the Hebrew. The Greek greeting is kairein, which just means greetings. Paul has changed kairein to charis, same root, only one letter changed. Greetings becomes grace. And then he picks up the Jewish shalom. But notice it's always in this order, and you notice that I've changed the order of the NIV. I don't even try to effect a change in the English, because grace and peace to you is the only way it will ever be read. But it reads in Paul, grace to you and peace. Always in that order, grace to you and peace. In a way, this is a compendium of Paulian theology. Peace means shalom, of course. It doesn't mean just the well-arranged heart. It means shalom in the community, a people of shalom. And the way that they come to being a people of shalom is grace. Grace to you. And the source is God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And listen to the high Christology in that. Grace to you and peace. God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ in one prepositional phrase. That is, it doesn't say from God and from Christ. It's from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. One preposition holding the two together. It's one of those, what I call incidental moments of very high Christology that many people overlook. Just God and Christ together, responsible for the grace. Now, very quickly, some things out of the next section that I want to just make note of. We've already noted the stuff in verse 8. Verse 9, I just want to call attention that God is my witness, whom I serve. Paul does this several times in his letters when he wants to stress a point. The thing that makes it so highly unusual here, of course, is that it breaks the thanksgiving and the prayer apart. But he feels this kind of compulsion that they understand that God will be the one bearing witness to the fact that he does, in fact, remember them all the time in prayer and give thanks for them. I think we have to take seriously that Paul does this, that he constantly prays and gives thanks for people all the time, even those who are not his own converts. Well, I want to skip to verse 11 in particular, because we've already noted Paul wants to impart some spiritual gift. This is the only place in the Pauline corpus where we have this combination of charisma pneumatikon. I mentioned this the other day. Charisma by itself does not mean spiritual gift. It means some concrete expression of grace. Even in our letter, 5:623, the charisma of God is eternal life. It just means that this is the expression of grace in the world is eternal life. In 11:29, he uses the word about the privileges granted, the gifts of God, the charismata of God that are granted to Israel. 2 Corinthians 1:11, it's a specific deliverance from death. And 1 Corinthians 7:7, it's celibacy and marriage. I mean, the word doesn't mean spiritual gift. It means a concrete expression of grace. It comes to be called spiritual gift because in 1 Corinthians 12, it's the word Paul uses to speak to those specific manifestations of the Spirit that are manifestations of grace in their midst. But charisma doesn't mean spiritual gift. Charisma has to do with the gracious thing that God is doing by the Holy Spirit in their midst. So you have this gracious gifting. It's when he adds pneumaticon to it. That's when it becomes spiritual gift, because pneumaticon is an adjective that means belonging to the Spirit, pertaining to the Holy Spirit. Now, an awful lot of confusion and frankly, bad exegesis has taken place on this passage in Romans, because we read this in light of 1 Corinthians 12, and then we ask, what spiritual gift did he want to impart? You know, tongues, prophecy? No! Come on. It's some gifting of the Spirit, some gracious gifting of the Spirit that Paul wants to impart to them. And I think in this case, it's the Spirit, it's the prophetic ministry that he's been given for the church that he's going to elaborate in Romans. If you will, Romans becomes this spiritual gift. But the thing that fascinates is verse 12, where having said that this is what he wanted to do, impart some spiritual gift in order to strengthen you, he backs up and says, that is, what I really mean is that we might be mutually encouraged by one another's faith. And that's the clear recognition that we're not talking apostle. That is, that we're not talking client, patron-client relationship, to use the sociological terms of antiquity. It's not patron-client, it's mutuality. He's going to speak into their midst authoritatively because of his calling, because of who he is. But when he gets there, he expects it to be a mutual encouraging because they both have faith in Christ Jesus. And then he goes on to indicate how he's wanted to come, but he couldn't, that he's a debtor to all. And that's what leads then directly into verse 16. Now, I think what we're going to do, and I think we need to do it today, is I'm going to go ahead and start with verses 16 and 17 when we pick up the rest of chapter 1. Partly because there is so much that's important in that text that we need to look at as anticipating an awful lot of things in the rest of the letter. So it's clearly a transitional sentence. That is, it's transitional in that it brings the thanksgiving to conclusion. It really does belong to the thanksgiving and prayer. But as a matter of fact, its content clearly serves as the heading for what follows. So we'll come back to it and speak to it then as at the heading of the material for next time.